Hi guys, this is Adam Gussow coming back at you with one more lesson on, there might be more lessons than one more, I don't know, we'll see. Anyway, a way of playing through the 12 bar changes on a harmonica that I found really useful, really useful in a practical way if I was playing in a band context, for example. You know, one of the most powerful principles on the harp is the principle of doubling. If you're in a band situation, or even if you're in a duo situation, and you can hear a line that's being played either by one of the other musicians, or maybe it's a line that's kind of internal to the guitar, and you can double it, okay? And you can really find the groove, find the pocket with the musician whom you're doubling. You can really make the music come alive. And the other nice thing is that you can play pretty loud while you're doubling. And nobody's going to mind, because what you're doing is fusing with, you're not drawing attention to yourself. This is the opposite from, let's say, somebody who, when they get asked to sit in and they're up there with a singer, is just, you know, just playing all over. And by the way, if you watch, I was watching, you know, the Millers, L.D. Miller, the wonderful young harmonica player, and his brother, and he doesn't step on his brother's vocals. I mean, he goes to town, man. He goes out front and plays his butt off. Okay, but he waits when his brother's singing. He's not stomping all over the vocals. There was only one very famous blues harmonica and guitar duo where the harmonica player constantly stepped. Well, there was two actually, where the harmonica player constantly stepped on the vocals of the guitar player. Sonny Terry and Brownie McGee. Go back and listen to Sonny Terry. And this is probably why Brownie McGee and Sonny Terry couldn't stand each other, why they feuded all the time, because Sonny Terry is always playing over Brownie McGee's vocals. Sounds good, though, and it took me 20 years to even realize that that was happening, but you can be damn sure that Brownie McGee knew it was happening. Anyway, I think Junior Wells used to do a little bit of that with Buddy Guy, too. It may be why they didn't last, and I did a bit of that with Mr. Satan, but over time I began to get hip. Okay, so here's another version. Let me just play you a couple of versions that I might use. In a song like Rock Me, which is a what I'd call a slow shuffle. That kind of rolling with a strong triplet rhythm. I might do something like that. Less is more, and especially if you're amplified, because you know it cuts so much. So I might cut it down a little bit, and you have to imagine that there's a whole guitar background, a whole band background behind me, right? And so what I'm doing is kind of flavoring, I'm spicing what's going on, but I'm not insisting on playing harmonica at every single moment. It's a really effective principle too. Find what works, and see how much you can edit out. Actually, I'm not even going to want to do the downbeat. I could do the two draw. If I was playing solo or playing with just a guitar player, I might. You to rock me like my back ain't got no bone. May we take two on that? I want you to rock me like my back ain't got no bone. I want you to rock me like my back ain't got no bone. So if I were doing something a little bit, that's, you know, you say, Gussow, don't sing. I was going to do something a little bit faster, I might do something like this. And I'm missing notes right and left. You know, if you don't hear a note and you expect one, that's because I just missed the note. So what can we get from this? Well, the idea of doing a chord form that begins with the tonic note hit pretty hard, in this case the two-hole draw, followed by 3-6 blow, which is the octave, 2-5 draw, which is the flat seventh, 3-6 blow, back to the octave. Just an interesting kind of form, and then you want to move it around and basically repeat the form, substituting the appropriate intervals, the appropriate notes, but it's the same intervals, same relational note to note when you change chords. So if I do, I'm going to do this four times. And then I'm going to go to the one blow, that's the root of the four chord. And me, I'm going to, being the lip purser that I am, I'm going to slide to the four blow. But I could go one blow if I want a tongue block. I could go to one blow, to 1-4 blow, and then shift over and do that blue third. Right? And then back up to four blow. And then I'm going to glissando down to the one draw. Now that was a revelation for me when I first realized, oh man, the equivalent, that 1-4 blow becomes the flat seventh when you're on the five chord. That was a revelation for me. And then I began to listen and I realized that a lot of harp players would hit the 1-4 blow octave when they hit the five chord. That's actually a really good lick, and it's one that I sometimes forget that it's there, but it really works well when you've got the chord background being played by somebody else, and you hit that flat seventh, that 1-4 blow on the five chord. Good stuff. So what am I doing there? One draw to 1-4 draw. All right, to 1-4 blow to 1-4 draw. All right, this is some basic stuff, but it's not easy stuff. I mean, it takes time to make it your own. I'm showing you the notes, but you got to play this in many jam sessions. You got to play it by yourself a lot. You got to play it in band contexts and begin to figure out what works and what sounds really good and what doesn't sound quite as good. And there are a lot of little adjustments you need to make. It's not like one size fits all. You can take these riffs and play them in a way that really that insinuates them into the overall musical context that you're playing in. And I think that's what you need to do. I'm giving you the tools, but I can't teach you how to play. Okay? That's really it for this lesson. We're through. We're out of time. And you'll be seeing me down the road. Okay? Take care and have a good one. Bye-bye.